Hello, my name is Robert Briner, and this is my presentation on my research paper, Rock the Vote. 2016 is a presidential election year, and these are some of the candidates. We have Bernie Sanders, Donald Trump, Ben Carson, Ted Cruz, and Hillary Clinton. The U.S. uses a first-past-the-post voting system, also known as a plurality voting system. The highest polling candidate wins based on the number of electoral votes obtained. Candidate who wins the majority of elections from each state wins all of the votes for that said state. The first-past-the-post, obviously, works heavily in favor of the two-party system. Voter eligibility. The U.S. Constitution states that suffrage, the right to vote, cannot be denied by the grounds of race, color, sex, or age, provided that the voter is at a legal voting age. Other than that, the eligibility of the voter is left to the state to decide. Some states refuse to allow any convicted criminals to vote. States like Iowa, Virginia, Kentucky, and Florida. In 2015, the Sentencing Project released a statement saying that approximately 5.85 million Americans are denied the right to vote because of a felony conviction. How does the election work? The president is elected every 4 years. The Electoral College is the main determinant of who will win the general election. The Electoral College is each state's representation, determined by how many House of Representatives and Senate members that they have in each state, which is determined by each state's population. Members of the electorate typically vote with their party, which does not allow for anyone outside of the two parties to really succeed in the election. The electoral system. Regulations on campaign finance and primary/caucus are very important when understanding the voting system. There is no mention of the two-party system in the U.S. Constitution. George Washington, our first president, was not a part of any political party. In fact, he strongly disagreed with the two-party system. But alas, the U.S. election has become a race between parties, regardless of the individual candidate's beliefs. And we have our Democratic Party, represented by the donkey, and the Republican Party, represented by the elephant. We have primaries and caucuses. Primary season starts from the Iowa primary in January until the final primary in June. At that point, candidates have been selected and the parties have all been chosen which candidate will be backing them up in the election in November. Caucuses are held in 7 out of the 50 states. They are gatherings where platforms of the candidates can be discussed openly, and the individuals campaigning try to win over the individual voters. Primaries are when members of the jurisdiction vote for a candidate who they would like to see in the ballot later on that year. Primaries can be open, semi-closed, and closed. So what's wrong with our voting process? There are a lot of criticism in the U.S. elections process. Most can be whittled down to the fact that the general population has little to no actual influence or voice in our so-called democratic state. In 2014, Princeton University conducted a study to determine the actual distribution of power within the American populace, trying to determine the influence from the elite versus the ordinary citizen. What they found showed us that the average citizen had almost a non-existent influence on public policy. They concluded that the U.S. has become more of an oligarchy than an actual democracy. Rather than being a nation for and of the people, it has become a government run by the few who can afford to have a voice. In conclusion, the government no longer operates in a way that represents the voice of the people. From first-past-the-post polling, voter registration issues, and the socioeconomic standing of the majority of the disfranchised members of the population, the methodology is flawed. It becomes very clear the Electoral College does not adequately represent the people. The two-party system disallows the chance or representation for people without enough financial standing to to have a meaningful voice. Without widespread reform, there is little hope for the U.S. to truly become the representative democracy it claims to be. The U.S. cannot claim to have a government that represents the people if millions, actual millions of its citizens, are stripped of their ability to vote. Lastly, the greatest determinant of our future, of our democratic process, is the lack of understanding by the general population. The people of this nation need to do their part to better understand the electoral process, rather than the few who have enough money to be heard. Thank you.